name's Michael Jacobs. I'm a professor of political economy at the Sheffield Political Economy Research Institute at the University of Sheffield in the UK. Delighted to be facilitating this session, which is called Reimagining a Political Economy for People and Nature. We're going to try and look at some of the economic and political economy questions which arise from the debates that we've been having so far. So one of our panelists is in Leeds in the UK. And there she is, Julia Steinberger. I'm just going to introduce very quickly our speakers, and then I'm going to tell you how we're going to try and run this session, which is going to be slightly different from the ones we've been doing before. So let's start with Julia, who is Professor of Social Ecology and Ecological Economics at the Sustainability Research Institute at the University of Leeds in the UK. Julia teaches and researches in the interdisciplinary areas of ecological economics and industrial ecology. Her work focuses on the connections and relationships between resource use and societal and economic performance, and she's currently working on a research project called Living Well Within Limits, investigating how human well-being might be achieved within planetary boundaries, and she's going to talk to us a little bit about that. She's a lead author of the IPCC's the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change's sixth assessment report. Heather Boucher is Executive Director and Chief Economist at the Washington Center for Equitable Growth. She is the author of several books. Her work mainly focuses on economic inequality and public policy, specifically around employment, social policy, and family economic well-being. She wrote, edited a really interesting book, gathering together essays on inequality called After Piketty, after the book Capital, the 21st Century, written by Thomas Piketty. And she has a book coming out very shortly, which I'm particularly excited about, which looks at many of the questions we'll be discussing today. Mark Paul here is Assistant Professor of Economics at the New College of Florida and a fellow of the Roosevelt Institute. He is a political economist, also works in the areas of inequality, environmental economics, and applied microeconomics, and has been working for the Roosevelt Institute on policy work for a Green New Deal, and he's going to talk a little bit about that. So that's who we've got. The method we're going to try and use is, rather than ask each of our panelists to give presentations to start one after the other and do a bunch of questions, we're going to try and kind of combine that with a slightly more conversational model. So I'm going to ask a set of questions to start with in the session, which I hope will cover the main topics. And I'm going to ask each of them to give one slightly longer answer to one of those questions each, which will give them a chance to say the things that they want to say. Two of the panelists have slides, so we can get the tech to work. We're going to have some slides in the middle of the conversation. We're going to start, in a way, I think, a key question which we've not really yet addressed directly so far in the conference, but which clearly arises from what we've been talking about, which is, what is the relationship between economic growth, human well-being, and environmental sustainability? We have a crisis of environmental sustainability. We've had that very clearly explained to us over the last couple of days. We have a clear crisis of well-being. We also have a system, as we've also pointed out, who's been thinking a lot about this, how she would answer that question. And Julia, you have some slides, I think, which you are going to control yourself. So, Julia.
I think we need to understand that the links between environment and economy happen mainly in two different mechanisms, and often we conflate the two. One is appropriation of resources and land, and the other one is waste emissions and outflows. These can't be entirely decoupled from each other, and they have very different effects in terms of well-being. So the links are very strong between environment and economy in terms of resource use and waste emissions. There's no evidence they can really be broken, and that's a problem. And I would also say that my third fact here is that capitalism is the cause, growth is the result. So we focus a lot on growth, but in fact, growth is sort of an outcome of capitalist structure, and growth in economic activity is not just a questionable policy goal, it's really structural to capitalism. And that is something we need to think about a lot more. In terms of how well-being links to the economy, well, first of all, I'm really delighted that Eric Weinhocker started us off with eudaimonic understanding, because That, I think, is absolutely the right way to go. And in particular, we've chosen within our project a needs-focused perspective on well-being, just to avoid confusion. So here I'm talking about the idea that well-being involves satisfying human needs, which are not just basic ones, to enable flourishing within societies. In terms of the link to the economy, between well-being and the economy, it's a very mixed link. So more is not always better. There's a lot of inequality. There's a lot of overproduction, exploitation, overconsumption, and not every dollar in the economy benefits well-being equally, and some is downright negative. So, and then if we think about the link between well-being and the environment, for instance, through the waste channel, that's always negative. I tried to think of a single positive example and couldn't find one. And if we get to the actual interesting thing, which is, well, what I think is interesting because it's what I research, the link between well-being and the environment as understood as physical resource use is a lot more interesting because unlike, you know, the economy, which grows at the expense of the environment, well-being does not always grow with resource use. There's such a thing as sufficiency. And so we see these thresholds of enough, and we can observe them out there in reality, which means that we can estimate how much resource use is related to well-being and how much resource use is not, which means that we can estimate how much resource use is excess or waste or luxury or however you want to call it. Some resource use is detrimental to well-being, or you can consider some resource use what we call a negative satisfier, like car dependence. People use cars to do things to function in society. They need a car in that sense, but it's a very negative satisfier of needs because it has all these negative side effects for health, for the environment, etc. Okay, now sufficiency is really interesting because sufficiency levels change. Sufficiency levels are not a universal across time and space and across societies. And so I think we can understand a lot if we try to understand sufficiency. So social organization is really important here. Supply chains, distribution, technical efficiency matters too, but it's not the most important thing. I just wanted to highlight some work my colleagues did on privatization and poverty, which shows that for the same kind of supply, you get very different well-being outcomes. So I would say that when we consider sufficiency and resource use, we see that immense change is possible. But I think we have to study what we call socio-technical systems of provision, and that we need to move towards ideas like universal basic services and disruptive policies like the Green New Deal. Now, to conclude, so implications for a new political economy, which is a big ask. I think a new political economy, we have to start by focusing on the real reality surrounding us, which means fossil fueled capitalism, and where growth of specific industries is not optional but inbuilt. And I'm delighted with the opening talk, obviously. I think this is exactly the direction we need to be going in. In terms of the future, which is right now, we need to start that future right now. We need to broaden the sphere of what you consider the economy past production, consumption, and profits. We need to focus on social function. We need to focus on labor. And we need to include ideas of social design, social movements, and again, ideas like universal basic services and energy democracy. And in terms of the scale of change we need, I think we should not kid ourselves. We're talking about something that's a civilizational shift. I would say going back more than a couple of hundred years in terms of the changes we need. And so we're not talking about restructuring or shifting the material basis, but really a complete rethink of our roles as citizens, activists, workers, family members, and good luck to us. So I'm really interested to hear the rest of the panel.
I'm not going to go to the rest of the panel yet. I want to hone you in on a question. You cite a paper that's very recently come out, the Hickel and Georges paper, which in yeah. New Political Economy, which makes a very important claim in this field, and trying to draw together some of the evidence on this. And I'm going to ask all the panelists, but I'm going to start with you because I think this is, in a sense, a crucial question. it seems to me absolutely clear that current patterns of growth are environmentally unsustainable. So if we're asking about growth and the environment, that's incontrovertible. The interesting question is, if we made all the changes that we need to do on the environment, is there any growth that is still possible left in the economy? This question seems to me to be critical to our understanding of what we're trying to achieve and what kind of economy we think we might achieve. So rather than saying, can we reduce environmental impact while growing, which we absolutely know we can, there's no question that we can reduce the environmental impacts while growth still occurs. The question is, can we get to sustainability while growth is still occurring? Or I'd put that the other way around, which is, if we achieve sustainability, would there be any room for growth left in the economy? Or is sustainability, in effect, something that would have to be achieved while no growth is in? So I want, green growth is the phrase that lots of people have been using to try and argue that you can, that these things are compatible. There's a kind of weak green growth, which is just a bit of environmental improvement, but a really strong view of green growth. Julia.
I think that if we understand that we have a capitalist system, and that capitalism, that is the system operating underneath the growth and the reality that we observe, I think that comes with a certain amount of baggage. So the environmental economic movement or research has not been suffering from a lack of good ideas. Good ideas have been there almost the whole time that would, in theory, allow certain kinds of decoupling. But what I would argue is that underlying structure of capitalism there's a reason that those good ideas were not taken up. It's not because they weren't good. It's not because they weren't win-win. Often they were. It's because that underlying structure has tendencies of overproduction, overconsumption, of constantly looking for new frontiers, of accumulation, that there are these core aspects of capitalism that will simply not, that have not allowed these good ideas to develop, and that will not allow them to in the present and in the future. So I think that we need to understand the systemic aspects of what underlies growth, because otherwise all the green growth ideas are going to remain nice ideas as they have for decades. And I think we're up against a power structure. I don't think we're up against a technical or policy problem, and I think that causal understanding becomes really important there.
Okay, I'm going to ask other panelists to pick up this question. You're not going to have too long on this one because we've got lots of other questions, but this does seem to be pretty central. Mark, do you want to come in on this one?
Great. So, the first thing I want to mention is that the whole point of the organization of our current system is growth, and the story that we've been sold is that through this growth we'll be increasing human well-being. And at some instances, that story held relatively true, for instance, in the golden age of capitalism here in the U.S. And in other instances, we've seen that story is completely broken down. Since the 1970s, we know that non-managerial workers, the vast bulk of the workforce, hasn't seen any increase, for instance, in their material living standards. And in this framework, the environment is simply another input in the production function. That's it. It fails to see the fact that the environment is the greatest common resource we've all inherited collectively, and that our job as a society should be to manage and protect that resource, certainly to use it for human well-being and flourishing, but to ensure that for future generations, they are able to inherit that resource as we inherited it as well. Which brings us to the question of green growth. I absolutely think green growth is possible, but I think it really comes down to the question of what do we mean by the term growth? Do we simply mean increasing our material standards of living, increasing GDP exponentially? I think that's a very poorly nuanced version of how to think about growth. Or do we mean actually increasing human well-being broadly, making sure that people have their basic needs met, making sure that people have actual economic opportunities as well as social opportunities? In that instance, I absolutely think that transitioning towards a sustainable economy is compatible with increasing growth. And I just want to put forth a word of caution. I think that the degrowth school is actually largely damaging to our current narrative for a variety of reasons. And in particular, one of those is thinking about an economic just society. We have 40 million Americans currently living in poverty. Go tell them we need to degrow. We have whole swaths of this world currently living below basic sufficient material standards. Go tell them we need to degrowth. So I think that we just need to reorient how we think about growth and really focus on decreasing our environmental footprint and really focus on addressing throughput of material resources while simultaneously increasing human well-being. And I think most importantly, we just need to start trying.
Heather.
So I'll just add, because we've already talked about Marx here, it's worth remembering the quote, accumulate, accumulate, that is Moses and the prophets, right? And that actually dovetails with what you just said, Mark, that it isn't about growth, but it's about the fact that capitalism, and especially the way that we see it now, is a system where the gains from human productivity are not shared. And so starting from the perspective that we shouldn't do that, because they haven't been shared, is kind of putting the cart before the horse. Let's talk about sharing before we start talking about what, you know, that we're going to pare that back.
In your work, Julia, you use the term well-being, and you use this in your presentation. And well-being is a term that many people now in the kind of in the non-orthodox field want to use. How do we make the concept of human well-being, Julia, operational? Or operationalizable, whatever the word is, in public policy terms. So we've all got a different sense, I suspect, of what well-being is. Is this really a kind of an alternative concept which we can use in the way we both think about economics but also make real in public policy?
I think that eudaimonic approaches to well-being are really important here, much more important than hedonic ones. And I think that operationalizing human well-being as this idea of human needs satisfaction, where human needs are a finite number of things. You can come up with different lists, but the lists all look reasonably similar, so that's going to be okay. And have this idea of sufficiency and threshold. So I think one of the things that's very an interesting approach is the approach of Doyle and Guff, who say that the overarching goal, it's not a very great ambitious goal. What they say is minimally impaired social participation. The idea is somebody is well if they can participate as fully as possible in our society, and then that's underpinned by physical health, mental health, and autonomy, and then those things are then in turn underpinned by a finite number of things like a safe environment, health system, an educational system. So I think that having those finite aspects that clearly build up to where people can see what the sort of hierarchy is in terms of building up to social participation and to being a full member of society is very promising. And it's also a lot better than a lot of approaches that are too abstract or aspirational, in my opinion, because it's something that you can orient social policy towards. You can, for instance, if you're thinking of the Green New Deal, you can orient parts of that policy towards need satisfaction. Are we targeting the different areas? Are we addressing them sufficiently and in an equitable fashion and so on?
That's great. Thank you, Julia.
Just a small thing. So how many of you have listened to Kai Rizzo talk about by the numbers on NPR? Could you imagine if rather than talking about the Dow Jones and the NASDAQ, which really mean nothing to the vast majority of people, he got on there and talked about, you know what, today we provided X Americans with health care. Or tomorrow he starts talking about the number of individuals that we were able to place in public housing rather than them being homeless. Or for instance, you know, the U.S. in 2021 has laid down 13,000 miles of carbon neutral train tracks that serves X million people. These are the numbers we should be talking about, not GDP, not the Dow Jones, and not the NASDAQ.
Let me say one sentence on that, which is there are funders in the room. I think that we should have a dedicated, I mean, I know they tried this before, but let's try it again, dedicated media outlets that are talking about the kind of economy that we want rather than the kind of economy that we're talking about. And that is an actual goal we could be working towards, and we need the money people to help us.
I'm going to shift us on because we're going to then come back to try and integrate this. So we have an environmental crisis. We've also got a crisis of inequality, of deep disparities, really wide disparities between the extremely wealthy and the poor, and living standards which are in the middle have stagnated for a long time. So let's go again to the core relationships, the relationship between growth and inequality. Heather, you've been studying this. What is that relationship, and is it possible to reduce inequality?
Yeah, well, so I'm realizing I don't have a clicker, so I'm hoping that there's some magic person that can move this. I have some slides that a fan. Oh, do I have to stand up?
No.
Oh, great. Okay, good. Okay, so they'll need to put the little slides up. So I'm going to go through these very briefly because you all know them, but there's been some, well, you actually know the first two. The other ones are a little bit different. So I want to start this answer to your question, Michael, with the point that unseating power is going to be hard because they have all the money. So let me just give you two slides to show this. This is data from Piketty and Saez and Zuckman. On the x-axis is the income distribution for the United States. On the y-axis is growth in income. And it's from the period from 1963 to 79. You can see over those decades, America was a country where we grew together. People at the bottom end of the income distribution saw the highest growth, people at the top saw the lowest growth, and that purple line across the middle is average national growth in income, essentially equivalent to GDP. So this story, the stories that Eric was talking about the role of how we think about the economy, how we think about progress, GDP was a useful indicator of something about equity for many, many decades, up to until the 1970s. You fast forward to today, and it is no longer a useful indicator, because GDP is no longer a useful indicator because we've become a nation that's growing apart, where 90% of people in the United States have been seeing growth on average since 1980 that is less than average GDP growth. So this question about how we think about economic performance, how we connect it to the conversation that we've been having, I think there is a really important opening here to connect the dots between, quote, what's good for the economy and what's good for the people that live in the economy. And that actually starts by unpacking GDP. And I would argue not in a really complicated way where we need to get into what some people might consider mushy things about well-being, but let's just start with the indicator we have and show in real time that it's actually not working for the vast majority of Americans. I've spent my career as an economist working in DC advising policymakers, and one thing I know is that A, they need a visual for their floor speech, and B, they need something concise that they can talk about. So disaggregating growth is something that we could be doing in real time. I'll note that today new GDP numbers came out for the United States, growth is a little bit over 3%. What I would really like to know is where that growth went. So this is an indicator of GDP over time, going back from 1963 to 2014. And that just shows US GDP standard. There was new data today that's at the end of that. This is a little bit outdated, but it's at the end of that bar there. And so you see what GDP looks like. What if today, instead of this blue chart, we saw something like this, which we would show on our new television station dedicated to economics for the people, whatever we would call it. Now, they fixed this actually in earlier iterations. So look at the green, and I apologize for anyone who's colorblind, but if you look at the green, those are the people who got all the money year by year. That is the top 1%. That is the share of annual GDP going to people in the top 1%. Imagine the different conversation we would be having about economic performance if every quarter we had to have a conversation about not just how the quote-unquote economy is performing, but who gained from that growth across the income distribution. So if our report, which is this is what it looked like today, I mean, obviously outdated because I don't have today's, but this is what the BEA, the Bureau of Economic Analysis report looks like, and this is what we want it to look like. So having a very different conversation. Now, obviously, that's not going to solve all our problems. I haven't said the word environment here. This is an interim solution to getting us to the conversation that we want to have, which is the economy should be working for people up and down the income spectrum. And this is also a bit of a soft pedal way to unpack how economic power leads to social and political power. Right? The challenge in front of us, as I've been sitting here listening to all of these wonderful discussions over the past couple of days, I feel like I'm carrying this weight of, my God, we have such an enormous challenge in front of us. And the forces that are, the powerful forces pushing against the wonderful ideas that we're talking about are so difficult. So, you know, how can we think each and every day? How are we going to bring the vast majority of at least people in our democracies along if we think that democracy is the right way to solve this problem, a conversation that is not puffed up at all, but maybe should? But how are we going to bring people along? And I think unpacking who is benefiting from economic growth will be a more compelling way to start than by saying to families like the community that I came from, you know, we don't want growth, we want you to give up everything. Because they're like, well, we didn't actually get it anyway. Look at that chart. We haven't been getting it. The rich people have been getting it. Take it from them. So figuring out how to make these two conversations go together, I think will be absolutely critical to the political project in front of us. So I kind of got off my talking points, but there you go.
Well, I want to possibly bring you back to your
Great.
Talking points, depending on what they were, which is Eric mentioned in his talk that the traditional neoclassical neoliberal view was that equality and growth were in trade-off. That essentially you got growth by rewarding the rich and actually suppressing the poor. Simultaneous, extraordinary kind of convenient set of incentives that appeared to work at either end of the income distribution. So you keep wages low and you incentivize corporate executives with higher pay, and that's what gives you growth. This is a very strong view, and it's one that has had a lot of kind of airing in the way in which economic policy is talked about. Is that right? Can you obviously want to reduce inequality.
Yeah.
How do you counter the charge that what you will do is you will suppress growth?
So two things. So first, I actually run a center dedicated to this question, so it's an easy one. I'll try to keep it quick. But this slide here, I put this purple bar across the across to make two points. One is to show you who's gained from growth. But two, and it's a little bit hard to see in the way I've showed it here, in this first period, growth was 1.8% on average per year. In the second period, it's only 1.4%. So from the get-go, we can have a conversation that actually growing apart has not improved growth in the United States. Let's just start there. So let's accept your premise. But then another sort of background point is that the challenge in front of those that made that argument was very high. Could you imagine sitting around being one of those businessmen that Kimberly Phillips Fine wrote about in the 1950s? How are we going to convince people that giving us all the money is in their interest? They had this enormous messaging challenge. Our messaging challenge is quite simple. We want to convince people that giving them the benefits of the economy will actually be good for them. Much simpler. This is actually the easy part. Right? So, but it is convincing the elites, the people in power, that, oh, the things that are actually good for humans, the things that actually improve well-being across the income distribution are actually good for growth. Fortunately for us, there is now a wealth of economic evidence. The new book that I have just finished is documenting the paradigm change that's happening in economics, showing all of the ways that heightened inequality obstructs, subverts, and distorts economic growth and productivity. It feeds into, in many ways, the conversation that Eric started this morning. We have all this empirical evidence because, quite frankly, new data, new computing power has meant that economists no longer have been sitting at their desks just writing little toy models and saying, well, this is the way the world looks, you know, from their armchairs. They actually have access to all of this data, allowing economists to look at heterogeneity for the first time in human history, really seeing how all of the different pieces fit together or don't fit together. And once you do that, there's all of this new research showing that actually things that are sort of common sense, but high inequality has, if you have high inequality, those children that are born at the bottom end do not have, they don't contribute to the economy as much because they don't thrive. Right? So if we understand that productivity is when humans thrive and they can contribute to the economy, if you have huge swaths of the population that literally aren't thriving because they're not getting enough to eat or they're not getting the right early childhood education, you can make that argument now in ways that you couldn't even do 20 years ago. So there is this shift within the mainstream of the profession because of this new empirical evidence that we could be building a strategy to get from here to the dare I say, utopian vision that Eric laid out this morning, that where we can use the tools we have.
Great. Mark, do you want to just come in on this question of growth and inequality?
Yeah, well, I want to spend a little bit of time actually connecting inequality to the environment, given that inequality and the environment are the two largest crises facing our time. And what's important to note is that these two crises are inextricably linked, and we often fail to draw that connection. First of all, we know through a tremendous amount of research that more unequal societies are associated with worse environmental outcomes, first and foremost. Okay? So that's something that we really want to think through quite deeply. So as we start tackling inequality, that actually not only will make it easier to address our environmental crisis, but we actually know that there are significant clear pathways through which it will help us create a cleaner environment. Second, and what is most troubling, is that climate change is going to disproportionately affect low-income people. This is true both here in the United States, we're currently sitting right near LA. Over the past 5 years, every year there have been dozens of deaths just in LA from heat-related deaths. Why? Because people lack essentials like air conditioning, for instance. As somebody who lives in Florida, who lives in the floodplains, it's traditionally poor people. These aren't people who also have the means to evacuate, for instance, when hurricanes, which are intensifying under global warming, come hit the state, which is happening with increasing frequency and intensity. Second, the solutions that most neoclassical economists have decided to peddle in the halls of Washington also disproportionately affect the poor. So here, we're damned if we don't address climate change for inequality, and we're damned if we do. And that's not something that we should be willing to accept here. Things like carbon taxes, renewable portfolio standards, CAFE standards, if they're not designed properly, if they're designed to maximize efficiency and maximize growth, they will have negative effects on the poor. And that's not something we should be allowing as policymakers and hopefully as funders in this room as well. However, I do think that we can address these simultaneously, but it requires a reorientation of our thinking, which I think we'll get to later on in the
panel. The Green New Deal has emerged over the last few months as an explicit attempt to try and say we haven't got two separate crises of inequality and environment. We've got one, and they can be addressed together, which is something that by and large has not been done by the communities of people interested in both those two issues. And the Green New Deal has kind of rocketed to public attention over the last few months. Mark, you've been working on it. So in your kind of estimation, what is it? Because it's been described as many things. But more importantly, how would we actually achieve it? What are the policies that can properly bring together these different goals?
That's a huge question. I can't fully address and give justice to it.
You've got 5 minutes,
yeah. So the Green New Deal, at its core, has been around actually for over a decade now. It's an idea. But here in this political context in the US, it's something quite specific. And what it is it's actually a resolution that has been introduced by Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and Senator Ed Markey, and initially championed by an amazing group of youth activists at the Sunrise Movement. And the resolution sets forth a number of goals and aspirations. And the point of these is to address our two crises simultaneously, the economic inequality crisis and the climate crisis. And it really identifies the fact that these are linked and inseparable. Importantly, the broad goals are that we decarbonize the economy and we provide basic economic necessities for all. That said, the exact policies within a Green New Deal are yet to be fleshed out. Those policies are being developed currently in a relatively democratic fashion to try to buy a broad and inclusive buy-in, in particular from activists, grassroots activists, and people on the ground. This is a complete different approach than what we saw, for instance, in the Waxman-Markey effort here in the US, which was complete insider baseball and failed miserably, unfortunately. We know that, given the IPCC report, and we saw the graph yesterday, we need to cut emissions by half in roughly 11 years, and we need to decarbonize fully within 30 years if we're to have any chance at reaching 1.5 degrees Celsius of warming. That said, countries like the US and UK, which are relatively wealthy countries and historically have outsized carbon footprints, don't have that kind of time. We need to be leading on a much faster time scale than fully decarbonizing by 2050, as the rest of the global community does. So we should be thinking about decarbonizing, for instance, by 2035 or somewhere in and along those lines. Most importantly, the Green New Deal represents a paradigm shift. In short, it's about the fact that it's not time to despair, but it's time to act. Importantly, it's about breaking out of our neoliberal shackles that have hamstrung climate action since I was born. In 1998, the year I was indeed born, James Hansen testified to Congress, raising the alarm bells, saying that the warming effect was real, and it is here. Economists, however, have stood in the way. For far too long, they told policymakers that we have to pit the environment against workers' livelihoods. We can either have a clean environment, or we can have economic growth and shared prosperity. This is something that Eric highlighted earlier today in his talk. Luckily, this is a false trade-off, and this is exactly the false trade-off that the Green New Deal seeks to highlight. Importantly, it seeks to reorient our thinking towards a Keynesian perspective where government has a major role to play in public investment and where we can actually address these two crises simultaneously. In order to do so, we need a broad-based agenda, including three primary pillars. And the way that I think about these pillars is as follows. First, we need broad investment, and that in the US has really been missing. When I talk about investment, there's two types of investment. We need direct public investment. There's things that the government should just be building, whether that be high-speed rail, green public housing, or even engaging in the build-out of renewables, such as through organizations like the TVA, which is a public corporation. Second, through investment, we should also be channeling the private sector to invest in the carbon-free future. As we know, the corporate sector has mountains upon mountains of cash they're currently sitting on and don't know where to invest. Through credit policy and through policy certainty, which is currently lacking, we can help channel that investment into building the clean future that we desire. Second, we need to think about environmental regulations. We simply need to outlaw things like internal combustion engines. We need to create new environmental regulations for buildings. Every building needs to be carbon neutral. California, for instance, just passed a groundbreaking piece of legislation that says that every home must have solar panels on it from here on out. There's a lot of examples where these regulations are really helping us make incredible progress. In the US, the biggest environmental regulation is CAFE standards, fuel efficiency standards for our vehicles, for instance. And third, we need to get prices right. And unfortunately, this is where economists have focused all their time and acted as if it's a silver bullet. And really, what they're talking about is carbon taxes. Carbon tax is fine, but the point of a carbon tax is to set a price on carbon. That seems a little bit silly to me, since the whole point isn't to raise a certain amount of revenue. The point of a carbon tax is to ensure that we meet our emissions goals. Thus, we should really opt for something like a carbon cap. One of the problems with this is that it's regressive. But we can fix that. All you do is you take the revenue from a carbon cap system and you rebate it back to the public in equal per capita measure through what we call a carbon dividend. As a matter of fact, this will help build buy-in to this policy by building support for the idea that we commonly own the environment. The carbon sink capacity of this environment is a common resource that we all inherited, that we all own, and that we should all have a stake in managing and ensuring that we protect that. What's vital is that these three pillars are complements. Again, economists for far too long have sold regulations and things like carbon pricing as utter enemies. We only need one or the other. But that's not the case. We need all three. And it's time to start building the bridges to show that any one of these areas alone can't bring us towards decarbonization. Second, to address the fact that we need to also tackle the inequality crisis, and given that decarbonization is not going to be easy, this is going to require a massive restructuring of our economy as we know it, we need to implement policies to ensure that no workers and no people are left behind. The primary policies highlighted are a Medicare for All agenda and a job guarantee, highlighting the fact that a job at non-poverty wages and health insurance are fundamental human rights that the government should indeed be providing to everybody in the United States in this instance. I'll close out by saying that personally, I'm actually quite hopeful. We have amazing groups like the Sunrise Movement leading action on the ground. They are hosting town halls all over the country. I suggest you post one yourself in your own community, get involved, become educated about what they're doing, and start moving things forward, because we simply cannot wait.
Mark, thank you. That's a really helpful explanation. Let's make this a bit more problematic. You mentioned that this was a kind of form of Keynesianism based on an investment program. In your contribution, Julia, you noted the problem of rebound effects, which, for those of you who don't know that term, the problem is if you reduce the environmental impact of something, for example, if the emissions, you make the economy more efficient, you are actually generating some income which will then be re-spent in the economy. And clearly an investment program is a program for new economic activity, new incomes, and so on. And some of that money could be reinvested in brown activities, polluting activities, and so on. So, Julia, are you happy with this description of the Green New Deal? Is there a risk that it is just the Keynesian program which reduces some emissions somewhere else but generates them through wider economic growth elsewhere in the economy? What's your view of this?
So I think the Green New Deal is great, partly because it does what Mark described in terms of tying these different policy issues together and reimagining a new economy as opposed to an opposing, pitting labor versus the environment versus the economy. And I think that it, I am much less worried about it being a Keynesian stimulus. I think it has a chance of being. But as long as the focus is on capping and reducing emissions and on strong redistribution, especially, for instance, with wealth taxes, so that we're going away from this wasteful resource use that does not contribute to well-being and ensuring that well-being happens and that people are able to participate socially through having jobs, through having healthcare, through having good quality, reliable public transportation, and so on, that allows an economy to be at the lowest level of possible of resource and highest possible level of well-being, whether or not growth happens. So in that case, I'm willing to be agnostic. I think it's, but then we're also not talking about capitalism anymore, right? We're talking about something that's been shifted quite significantly and where the centers of power of the fossil fuel industries and of the super wealthy people have been significantly reduced or taken out of the picture entirely, which I think is absolutely necessary.
There is the urgency of both, I would argue, the inequality problem and the environmental problem. Here's a set of ideas, and I think, Mark, you actually undersell the fact that many of the things you're talking about have been tried and tested. Right. This is not like, so when we put this label on it, there's a sense of excitement that it's something new. But I think we also are underselling the fact that a lot of this stuff is stuff that's already been done either in the United States or in a city or a county or a state or in other countries. And that's sort of like, you know, I know that because I'm a researcher and worked on some of these issues. But making sure that everybody understands that these are things that we know we can do. And I think the big question that you're putting on the table, Michael, is what if we did them all in this way at this time? How's it going to intersect with the business cycle? How's it going to fit? Well, part of the answer, I mean, the honest answer is, well, we aren't going to know until we try, but we do know that the specific pieces can be effective. I'll also note that I think that one of the things that's most exciting about this package is that it's taking, it's pushing forward on the climate and saying, okay, yes, we've had these debates over time. Now we need to just do some of anything, all of them, and let's move forward. But pairing that with a set of ideas around taxing wealth, around dealing with monopolies, that is that 1-2 punch. And because it's so many different things, we don't know the outcome. I would also, though, stress that from my perspective as an economist, I think that the more important economic pieces are what are the focus on the places at the top of the economy rather than the bottom. I think that, you know, the job guarantee might be a good idea. I have a lot of concerns about public sector employment, which we could talk about extensively, I think. So I have concerns about that, but there's good and bad. But I think that the things at the top that are going to change the incentives of the system are really where the power of this is going to lie, because that's where you're actually trying to wrest power from those who have it.
Do you want to come back?
Yeah, I'd like to make just a couple quick comments, and there's far too much here to dig into. But so one thing is that, and I'm speaking here for myself, not for the Green New Deal more broadly, but the Green New Deal has been sold as an investment package. And what's really important to address your primary question here is that it can't just be about the investments. It needs to be about investments. It needs to be about regulations. It needs to be about getting prices right, given that we live in a market-based economy. Those regulations function as a backstop to ensure that what you brought up doesn't happen. So what's critical is we need to talk head-on about phasing out the fossil fuel industry. Okay? We need a managed decline, a managed rapid decline of that industry. The easy things are eliminating fossil fuel subsidies. In the U.S., we subsidize the fossil fuel industry to the tune of $20.5 billion a year of corporate welfare. That simply needs to end. Second, we need to halt fossil fuel infrastructure immediately. That's a task that can happen today. And then third, I think we need to talk about how is it we engage and manage decline, because markets don't allow for an entire industry to simply be phased out easily and while ensuring that workers are putting first. You know that workers will end up on the bottom of the coal ash pile, so to say. Second is we build that carbon neutral economy, right? So those two things go hand in hand. One thing that both Julie and Heather brought up is thinking about things like wealth tax and taming power at the top. We talk about Pigovian taxes all the time. Right? Classic Pigovian tax is thought of as a carbon tax, for instance. But I also want to bring up the fact that a wealth tax, for instance, is a form of a Pigovian tax. Right now, the wealthy create this oligarchy that we currently live under in the U.S. If we were to implement wealth taxes and high top marginal taxes to start taming that power, it would help us transform from an oligarchy towards a democracy. But I do think that we cannot exclusively focus at the top. We need to tame power at the top, while ensuring we have a reasonable floor for individuals at the bottom. We cannot allow them to base their livelihoods off of chances within some semblance of a free market.
I want to ask a kind of theory question, just you're all economists of one kind or another. And Eric challenged us in a sense and said we need a complete overturn of the way we think about the economy, that economics is basically, so it's not just the policy or the political end, but actually the foundations of economic thought have led us to where we are today. It's kind of family, the tree that led to the extinction. So I want to ask each of you, and your answer's going to have to be short here, not quite yes or no, but not the full essay. Do we, in order to achieve the goals that we're kind of sharing here, do we need a complete change in our economic theory? Have we got long enough to get that agreed by everybody? Or actually can it be done with the way we think about the economy right now? Julia, I'm going to start with you and then I'm going to...
I think we don't have to reinvent everything entirely. I think we can just let other existing side-by-side theories of the economy, including Marxian theory of capitalism, which I think is still very helpful, not necessarily the socialist part, but in terms of like how you actually understand what capitalism is. And there are all kinds of heterodox ideas around political economy. I think those all exist, so we just need to sort of bring them back out of the closet. And I think that we also need to recognize, I mean, I'm a former physicist, that economics is a social science. It is not a predictive, exact science, and that it needs to bring become much more friendly with political science, with sociology, with psychology, and with, you know, the rest of the sphere of humanity, pretty much. And I think that then we can do it. I don't think that we need to invent a heck of a lot of things.
Heather?
So, I mean, I earlier said I think that there are steps we can take now, and I think we can build on where much of the cutting edge of the economics profession is to move us forward. I think that there's a lot of people, there's certainly a lot of people within that discipline that are just as concerned about the environment as we are, and so I think that, and there's a lot of them, so I think making allies and moving forward, I think is certainly something we should do. But I think also, though, a question that we have to confront when we're thinking about, and Eric did a nice job of with his Russian dolls, thinking about the foundations, the moral foundations of our, how we think about the economy and how we trace this down to individualism is one key component. And a lot of the values that we want to move our economy towards, which are in many ways traditional values, I mean, I have so many questions about the social parts of that. So many questions about what kinds of institutions will support those values. I have a lot of questions as a feminist. Liberalism has been incredibly good to women, both in our country and around the world. It's given women freedoms that earlier generations did not have because they were not put into these social structures that were more constrained. How do we imagine a future where we have more collectivism, more focus on collaboration, and sort of the things that are very human about us, while still maintaining, I mean, or are we giving up on maintaining some of the things that focus on individualism brought us? And that, I think, is where, you know, and even the conversation, oh, well, we need to make sure that we bring the core along. Well, that's because we think that those individuals are important, right? We're going to bring us all together. But is that, how do we reckon, how are we going to think about this in a new imagining of the economy? And Julia, you said, you know, Marx's analysis of capitalism is great, but the socialism part, I've actually said that exact same sentence before, but if we're going to do this, we have to think about how is it that humans can better work collectively, and how do we think about that with our democracy? So, I mean, right, liberalism, democracy, they went together, right? Individuals in politics, individuals in the economy. So I have a lot of questions about as we move to this. As an economist, we have our set of ideas. We understand that those are flawed. We need to move to new ones. But how are we going to work with other disciplines to think about all of the other pieces that need to be thought through?
Yes, we do need a paradigm shift. No, we don't have time. So the answer is start freaking trying right now. Deploy, deploy, deploy. Yeah. Every policy that can start sucking carbon out of the atmosphere, every policy that can halt more carbon from being polluted into the atmosphere, we need to try now, not tomorrow. Second, you know, we need to start thinking about an economics that ensures that we live within our planetary boundaries while reorienting away from maximizing profits, and in particular short-term profits, towards maximizing human well-being and protecting and promoting the environment. And there's a lot of work that's been done on this, and as somebody who's a strong advocate and supporter of eco-socialism, that's a great place to start looking and thinking, for instance. And when I say that term, I'm not talking about Venezuela. What I'm talking about is libraries, okay? What I'm talking about is K-12 education here in this country. We have all sorts of goods that we decided to take out of the marketplace and decided that, you know what, we shouldn't means test whether or not you have access to a book. Everybody should have a library in their neighborhood. They should be able to go get those books. They should be able to check them out. They should be able to benefit from those collective resources. And that's what I'm talking about when I think about how we reorient.
So I think the principles of just transition and the fact that the labor unions that are left have in fact been starting those conversations is really important. And so I think that we need to include those workers who are often not the biggest fans of their own industry. I mean, coal miners are not treated well by the coal mining industry, so et cetera. So I think that the concept of a just transition has to be followed, and we need engagement across the board. So I think that that's clear, and the job guarantee and the Green New Deal goes a long way to addressing that. I wanted to say something a little bit around organized labor and around some of Heather's questions, which is I think that one of the things that we've lost through this, through what Eric was talking about at the beginning in terms of our ideology or morality of the individual, is we've lost a capacity to work together. It's almost as though that's been like deliberately harmed, and it's not something we learn in schools, and I think it's something that we should be learning a lot more. Is collective working processes, collective bargaining processes, but just sort of working together. And I wanted to recommend something that I think is a really interesting approach, which is called a book called Radical Health. And it's about this idea of social design around reimagining the welfare state. And I think it addresses some of these issues around how we do things, how we can do things really quite differently than central command and control welfare state, and how we can reimagine family engagement, community engagement, and so on. And I think that it's not just, we're not just workers or citizens or family members. We need to learn how to navigate these different spaces together coherently, and I think that helps with all of these decisions in terms of not leaving these different aspects behind.
What a nice way to end, reimagining the way we do an economy and we think about an economy. We hope that's given you some food for thought this morning. Thank you to all of you for listening. Can I thank the panel? Julia, thank you very much for taking part by video from the UK.